In this lesson, we'll talk about how you can expose your application running in Kubernetes to the internet, or in some cases only within a VPC. When you create a typical service of type load balancer for your application, Kubernetes knows how to create a cloud load balancer, no matter which cloud provider you use. AWS, Azure, or GCP. This task is performed by the Cloud Controller Manager that ships with Kubernetes and contains the logic for creating basic resources in different clouds. When it comes to AWS, for a very long time, it would by default create a classic load balancer. You can use specific annotations to change the type, scheme, and other configurations. However, this functionality is still tied to Kubernetes source code, which means the development team responsible for that cloud logic must wait and go through the Kubernetes release cycle. As you can see, this is not very convenient and slows down the release of new features. Currently, it is deprecated and only receives security and bug fixes. Another issue with using legacy Cloud Controller Manager when creating a load balancer is that it adds all your Kubernetes workers to the target group and uses node ports behind the scenes to route traffic. This approach adds additional network hop, and if you run very large Kubernetes clusters, there is a hard limit of 500 nodes or so that you can add to the target group. Now, since Kubernetes became incredibly popular, cloud providers started to develop their own controllers to handle the specific cloud logic. For example, AWS has AWS Load Balancer Controller that you can additionally install in Kubernetes, usually using Helm chart. This controller can create load balancers and ingresses, a feature that was never added to the original cloud controller. Since it's a separate project hosted in its own repository, it has independent release cycle. This allows cloud providers to develop new features and quickly release them to the public. One of my favorite features is that since we use the native VPC network when creating EKS cluster, each pod gets VPC routable IP addresses. This means you can directly add pod IP addresses to the load balancer target group. Now, there are two types of ingresses available to you, each with its own pros and cons. For example, when you use AWS Load Balancer Controller to create ingresses, it creates a layer 7 application load balancer. It understands HTTP protocol, and you can use it to route requests based on the host header, HTTP path, or even HTTP verbs such as GET and POST. As a target group, it directly adds the pod's IP addresses. I should mention that instance mode is still available, but IP mode is more efficient, and we'll use that instead. The logic for routing requests is outside of Kubernetes cluster. For example, when you decide to secure your application with TLS and HTTPS, you need to obtain a TLS certificate from AWS Certificate Manager Service and use annotations to attach it. This way, you don't have to keep the certificate and private key inside Kubernetes to terminate TLS. On the other side, we have traditional ingress controllers such as Nginx, Traffic, and many others. All of them are deployed in Kubernetes as regular applications. When you install external ingress controller, it creates a layer 4 network load balancer, which will be the gateway for your application. Each request will go through, in this example, Nginx controller pod, and then be routed to your application. The logic for routing requests is inside the Nginx pod. To secure your application with TLS, you need to deploy Cert-Manager, which automatically obtains and renews certificate from Let's Encrypt. Keep in mind that you have to store certificate and private key inside Kubernetes and mount them to the Nginx pod. This way it can terminate TLS and route traffic to your application. Since we have a proxy, it adds complexity, but we can collect Prometheus metrics from a single place for all applications. For example, you can get metrics such as requests per second, latency, availability, and other metrics. With application load balancer, you would need to get metrics from AWS site. Also, when using a traditional ingress such as Nginx, we share a single load balancer across applications inside Kubernetes. If you use AWS load balancer controller, it creates one application load balancer per ingress. There are some workarounds, but in production, you would most likely stick with that approach. In my opinion, you definitely want to install AWS LoadBalancer controller and create a network LoadBalancer for the Nginx Ingress controller using IP mode, which we'll do in the following lesson. Alright, let's go ahead and create necessary Terraform components. This controller also needs access to AWS to create load balancers. To grant access, we'll use pod identities as well. In the previous example, we used assume role property on the role itself. In this case, we do exactly the same, but for creating assume policy, we use a data resource. Next, we create IAM role and attach this assume policy to it. The previous example created the same role using a single Terraform resource. This example splits the creation into two objects. Next, we need to create IAM policy for the AWS load balancer controller that defines actual permissions in AWS. Again, there are a couple of ways of doing this. In the previous example, we created a policy using a single Terraform resource. In this case, we will create a JSON IAM policy file and load this policy into Terraform resource. Then we need to attach this policy to IAM role, which will be used by this controller. Finally, we need to link this IAM role with Kubernetes service account, and we'll also deploy this controller to kube system namespace. Alright, we finished configuring IAM permissions, and next we need to deploy a controller using a Helm chart. This Helm chart requires EKS cluster name. The Kubernetes service account name must match the one you linked in EKS. Also, let's depend either on the node group or the previous Helm chart. This Terraform file contains all necessary components to deploy AWS load balancer controller to EKS, but we still need to create that IAM policy file. It's going to be under IAM folder. It's pretty large IAM policy and doesn't have any constraints. For example, if you wanted to dynamically add resource constraints, you would probably use template file Terraform function and pass it during creation. I showed an example in the previous section. Now, let's go ahead and apply it. Let's make sure that the controller is deployed and running. For the first example, we'll use a simple deployment and create a service. To use AWS load balancer controller, you need to use load balancer type annotation. Otherwise, in3 legacy cloud manager controller will be used. I also suggest using IP mode instead of instance mode to avoid routing your requests through the node ports. You can configure it to be public with public IP address and accessible to anyone on the internet, or you can create it as internal, which would have only a private IP address and be accessible only within the VPC. Optionally, you can use a proxy protocol if your application needs to know the actual client source IP address, otherwise it will get load balancer source IP. I added a link to all possible configurations available through annotations at the top of the file. That's all the YAML we need for the first example. Let's go ahead and apply it. Let's get the services in our namespace. It may take a few minutes for the load balancer to show up under external IP. If it's not there, check AWS load balancer logs. You may have misconfigured permissions, and the controller may not be able to provision load balancer in AWS. Let me show you this load balancer in the console. You can see this load balancer, but it is still in the provisioning state. Usually, it takes a couple of minutes for the load balancer to transition to the active state. Under details, you can see that it is a network load balancer, which means it's a layer 4 load balancer. It's a little bit cheaper and faster than application load balancer provided by AWS. Also, if you used the legacy cloud manager controller, it would provision a classic load balancer. Under the scheme, you can see that it is internet-facing, so anyone can access it. Just a heads up, don't use internet-facing load balancer to expose your internal services and dashboards, such as Prometheus and Grafana. In the first section of this tutorial, we created a VPC with subnets and used special EKS tags to inform EKS where to provision public load balancers. You can see that both of those subnets are public. Now, let's refresh it one more time. Now it's active, which means it's ready. Let me show you one more thing. Under Listeners, you can open the target group that is used by our load balancer. You'll find that since we used IP mod for the load balancer, it does not add all the Kubernetes nodes to the target group. Instead, it added a single pod IP address. This is the biggest advantage of using IP mod. There is no restriction on how many nodes your Kubernetes cluster can have. As far as I remember, if you use a classic load balancer, it will create a node group out of all EKS nodes, and it can only add a maximum of 500 nodes. Also, let's wait until the health status is healthy. Don't test your load balancer until you verify all these details. Let me get the pod IP just to prove that the target group is using this IP address. Now, we can use curl and hit the load balancer. Alright, it works, and we got the version back from our application. That's all for the first example. Let's delete this namespace. In addition to creating load balancers, this AWS load balancer controller can create ingresses. It ships by default with ALB ingress class. In the following example, we'll create a plain ingress to expose our application. We have the same deployment object. Then we have a service of type cluster IP. If you want to create ingress using instance mode, not IP mode, instead of cluster IP, you would use node port even in the cloud. Then we have ingress resource. The important part here is that our application should have a health check that returns a 200 status code. We also have the same internet-facing value as well as IP mode. Now, to test this ingress, you can use exactly the same host. We're not going to create a DNS record for this example, and I'll show you how to test it locally. That's all for the ingress. Let's apply it. Get ingresses in our namespace. Again, it may take a few minutes for the load balancer to show up here. Let me open this application load balancer that was created by the ingress resource. You can see under load balancer type that it is application load balancer. Application means it understands HTTP and can route traffic based on HTTP path or a verb such as get, post, etc. It is also created in the public subnets. Alright, let's wait until it's provisioned. Now, under the listener, you can find the role with the pod IP. You can see that the target is pod IP address. If you had more pods, you'll get more IP addresses here. It's healthy because our health check returns 200 status code. Now, let me show you how to test it without creating DNS. This is actually a very useful technique even in production if you want to test your application before changing DNS record and sending live traffic to it. To test, you can use a header with our host. Keep in mind, since it's ingress, we don't need to use port 8080 anymore as we did with the load balancer. Alright, it works. Let's delete this example as well. For the final example in this section, we'll need a TLS certificate to secure our ingress. For the application load balancer, we cannot use Let's Encrypt and need to obtain a TLS certificate from Certificate Manager, a managed AWS service. You can do this even if you host your own domain outside of AWS. But in my case, I use Route 53, and most likely you would do the same. Now, we need a public certificate. Here you would provide your domain name. You can add additional names below as well. For example, if you have devopsbyexample.com and www.devopsbyexample.com, you would need to put two domain names here. Next, we select DNS validation and use default RSA key type. Now, we have created the certificate request. Next, we need to prove that we own our domain. In the case of DNS validation, we need to create a couple of CNAME records for each domain on the certificate. If you host your domain in Route 53, it's very easy. Just click the Create Record button and it will be done automatically for you. Now, we need to wait a few minutes until DNS is ready and AWS is able to verify it. Let me go to Route 53 to show you the records that I have and the one that was created to validate ownership. Down below, I have a record to validate certificate. Let's refresh one more time and it looks like the certificate was issued. To be able to use it, we need to copy certificate I ran and paste it into Ingress. Alright, this is the third example for this section. We have exactly the same deployment and service object. The difference is here, we need to replace this IRN with our new certificate. The next annotation is to configure redirect from port 80 to port 443. This basically means if anyone tries to access our application using HTTP, they will be immediately redirected to HTTPS. It's a very common redirect, so I suggest you keep it unless you have a specific requirement. It will be public as well. IP mode and the health check. You may notice that this ingress does not have a TLS section. It's because TLS will be terminated outside of the Kubernetes cluster on the application load balancer. So there is no need to keep certificate and private key inside Kubernetes. This is very different from the Nginx ingress controller that we'll discuss in the next section. Also, in order to use AWS LoadBalancer controller to create ingress, we need to specify its ingress class name. A long time ago, we had to use ingress annotations. Now it's done through the special ingress class name property. Alright, we can apply it now. Let's get the ingress. To test this ingress, we can create a DNS record. But before we do that, let's wait until the application load balancer is provisioned. Also, let's check if the pod is healthy under the target group. Now we can create a DNS record. It's going to be a CNAME record, and for the value, we'll use LoadBalancer DNS. Let's wait a few minutes and check if we can resolve DNS for our application. The final test is to make sure that we have a valid certificate in the browser. It looks like the connection is secure and we have a valid certificate which was issued for a year. When using Let's Encrypt, your certificates valid for 90 days and automatically renewed every 60 days. Alright, let's delete this example. In the next section, we'll do pretty much the same, but we'll use Nginx Ingress Controller and additionally install Cert-Manager to obtain certificate. I'll also cover the differences and share my opinion on which controller you should use and why.